Stand for the reading of our text for this sitting. Those who are streaming with us, you can stand also in honor of the Word of God as we share, as we read. Thank again the Lord for our clinicians and those of you, of course, who are present, the officers of our church. And we thank the Lord for this day. Our text is found in Psalm 8. And we'll read, verse 2 for our hearing. Out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have ordained strength because of your enemies, that you may silence the enemy and the avenger. I want to speak for a few moments from the subject entitled, Why the Future for the Faithful is Fixed. Amen. You may be seated. Why the future for the faithful is fixed. Amen. We thank God again for this chance to share. We do ask for your prayers. As I always share, preaching and praying are good friends. They love to hang out with one another. And I've never graduated out of the kindergarten class of prayer. You never get to a point to where you are beyond the need of prayer. You never get to a point to where you are promoted beyond that need. All of us are here because somebody, somewhere, prayed for us. I think that I say that again. We're here because somebody, somewhere, prayed for us. And since we are the beneficiaries of the prayers of others, we benefited from their prayers, then we are obligated to pray for one another. Amen. The word ordained in our text, it depicts for us or describes for us something that is fixed, something that is stable, something that cannot be moved. The word that is translated ordained in the Hebrew, it is often used of structures that are built on a firm or a fixed foundation. Now, any structure that is built, if it is going to have any type of sustainable future, then that structure has to be built on a sure foundation. Any structure that is built, if it is going to be able to confront the wind and the storms that will beat against it over the years, that structure is going to have to be built on a fixed or a firm and stable foundation. Listen, this psalm, Psalm 8, verse 2, it brings to us or presents to us a good word of encouragement. And that word today is that the future, yes, for the faithful has been fixed by God. God has ordained it, and since God has said it, his word, as the book called the Bible declares, and his word is settled in heaven, and since what he has ordained in his word is settled in heaven, then it is settled on earth, regardless of what others say about it. God's word is fixed, it's firm, and it's not going anywhere. And that's what the psalmist is trying to declare to us. Since God has spoken these words, that the future of the faithful, yes, it is fixed, then that communicates to us that it doesn't matter what time it is, there will always be some faithful folk who are hanging around. Doesn't matter what year it is, doesn't matter what century it is, God's people will always be around. Say amen. Listen, you ought to share with a neighbor. Neighbor, I'm not going anywhere. And every now and then you need to tell the devil, listen, I'm not going anywhere. There will always be those around in the future who will stand up for Jesus. Somebody ought to say amen. Somebody's streaming ought to tell the Lord thank you, because you are part of that fixed future. And the reason why we are here is because the Lord had raised us up so that we might be able to stand up for him and our generation. I know they want us to go away, but no, believers will always be hanging around. Why is this necessary? Why is it necessary for children of God, for those who are faithful, to simply be around? Well, I'm glad you asked. It's right here in the text, the reason why there's a need for the faithful, yes, for their future to be fixed, is because in every future of every believer, they're going to be confronted with, and they're going to stand face to face with, the enemies of God. Listen, it's there in the text, out of the mouths of babes, sucklings, and nursing infants, yes, the God has ordained strength because of God's enemies. And what that is communicating to us, if they hate God, then they hate those who love God. I say that again, there are God haters all around, and since they hate God, they hate the faithful who are in love with God. And so since in every future of every believer there will be haters of God around, then God has fixed it so that in every piece and portion of every future there will be faithful ones hanging around to do business with the devil. Somebody ought to tell the Lord thank you. Thank you that he called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light, because somebody has to be around to handle the devil. Amen. Amen. It's right here in our text. So God ordained it. Yes, fixed the future, yes, for the faithful, so that in every generation, first of all, there will be somebody hanging around who will be, yes, his mouthpiece. Say amen. I said in every future, God has fixed it so that in every generation, there'll be folk hanging around who will be his mouthpiece. It's right there in the text. The psalmist declared out of the mouth. Look, it's right there, out of the mouth of babes. wives and nursing infants. Now, you have to understand that this is nothing new to the Lord. Our God can do anything but fail. I think that I say that again. The God we serve can do anything but to fail. And since God is God, God can do what he wants, when he wants, and how he wants, and he can use who he wants. Somebody ought to say amen. It's right here in our text. It's nothing unusual for God to target an infant. Yes, to use that infant for his glory in the future. All you have to do is turn to Jeremiah chapter 1 and you can read about Jeremiah's call. Yes, God was calling him to the ministry, and Jeremiah declared, Lord, I'm just a young fella. I don't know how to quote scripture. The Lord told Jeremiah, now Jeremiah, I need to stop making excuses, because I called you before you were formed in your mother's womb. Say amen. He said, even then I knew you. And what the Lord is saying, Jeremiah, before you became a nursing infant, I knew you in your mother's womb before conception. And that means before the sperm, yes, fertilized the egg, God knew Jeremiah, had called him to be a prophet for the Lord, and also had given him a task. Somebody ought to say hallelujah. Yeah, because God can use even infants who will grow into his future for his glory. Listen, we serve God. Listen, if you are here, that means that God knew you before you were formed in your mama's womb. You ought to tell the Lord thank you. If you don't have anything to thank God for, just thank the Lord for knowing you personally and intimately as a person before you were formed in your mother's womb. If you are here and if you are part of the faithful, that means God declared, ordained you to be here before you were formed in your mother's womb. You ought to tell the Lord thank you. Listen, nothing is unusual or strange with the Lord. Not only will the Lord use, yes, infants, the Lord will use children to be his mouthpiece. Listen, all you have to do is turn over to the book of 1 Samuel, and you will discover where the prophet Samuel went down to Jesse's house, and Jesse had 8 sons, and God sent the prophet Samuel down there to anoint the king of Israel. What Jesse had 8 sons, and then Jesse paraded all of his older 7 sons before Samuel, and Samuel looked at son number 1 and said, that's not him. He looked at son number 2 and said, that's not him. He looked at son number 3 and said, that's not him. He looked at son number 4, he said, that's not him. He looked at son number 5, that's not him. He looked at son number 6, that's not him. He looked at son number 7, and Samuel said, that's not him. Do you have any more boys hanging around here? Well, Jesse said, I got a 12-year-old boy out there in the field, shepherding the sheep. He's a ruddy little fella. He's all dirty every time he comes in. I got to bathe him, because all the dirt that that he has accumulated separating the sheep in the field. I have to watch it all when he comes home. Psalm Samuel said, bring him to me. Here comes little 12-year-old David, and he stood before Samuel, and Samuel said, that's the king of Israel. You ought to look at somebody and tell him, listen, calling children, using them as his mouthpiece is nothing. Yes, for the Lord. Listen, not only did God call David at the age of 12, but you look over in 2 Kings, yes, there, and you will find in chapters 11 and 12 where God called a king by the name of Joaz. And when Joaz ascended, or should I say, when he was placed on the throne, ascended to the throne, Joaz was just 7 years of age. Look at somebody, say 7. Yes, 7 means 7. He was 7 years old, and the Lord used him, yes, to renovate the temple. Well, is God through? No, just turn over in that same book, 2 Kings, yes, chapters 22 and 23, you will discover that God called a king by the name of Josiah. Yes, and then when God called him, he was but 8 years of age. Look at somebody and say 8 years of age. In 2 Kings chapters 11 and 12, God called Joaz, who was 7 years of age, who ascended to the throne. In 2 Kings chapter 22 and 23, God called Josiah, who ascended to the throne at the age of 8 years old. And during the tenure of Josiah, they found a portion of God's law, brought it to the young king, handed to him, and he opened up the scroll of God's book and read it. I think that I say that again. And during the tenure of King Josiah, who ascended to the throne at the age of 8 years old, yes, the prospectors in their digging found a portion of God's book, yes, the law, and they handed it to the king. He opened it up and read it. I still need to say that again. Y'all still didn't get it. And listen, I said they brought the book to him. He opened it up and he read it. They're still not getting it. Listen, they brought the book to the boy. The boy opened up the book. He didn't keep the book shut and set it on a coffee table. No, the boy opened up the book and read the book. Listen, when God gives us his word, just don't look at it. No, don't lay it on the coffee table. Don't lay it on the mantle. You open that book up and you read that book. And when you read that book, the words in that book will bless your life. Somebody ought to say hallelujah. When Josiah opened up the book and read the book, he looked at the words in the book and said, we're not doing what God told us to do. He took the book, had somebody to read it to the people, and when they read the book to the people, revival broke out in the city of Jerusalem. Listen, if you want revival to break out in your life, you need to take the book, open up the book, read the book, live the book, and the book will bless your life. Somebody ought to say the problem is just 8 out of the mile of babes and nursing infants. God said in every generation, I'm going to have a mouthpiece to speak for me. The future for the faithful is fixed.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
And hallelujah.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Well, where the Lord had to fix, the future for faithful, because in every generation, God is going to have someone who will be his mouthpiece. And certainly God fixed the future for the faithful, because in every generation there has to be somebody around in whom God's strength can be found. Amen. Say amen.
Amen.
There has to be somebody around who, yes, the God can use, but they have to be humble enough for when God exercises miracles through them, and when God uses them to bless somebody else. God has to make sure that person doesn't get beside themselves. Say amen. And so when we humble ourselves and God works through us to bless somebody else, then our testimony is this: it is not what I have done, but it's what the Lord has done for you through me. I am but a human. God is God. God needs folk around who are humble enough. Say humble enough. When God does great things and through them, they don't get beside themselves. They don't get the big head. They don't start talking about what they've done. No, it's all about what my God has done through me. And I reminded some years ago, there was, an individual in the hospital. I went by, and I prayed for them. And they were on their bed of affliction. And, it didn't look good, but I prayed for them. And they recovered. And they called me, soon after that to say, "Reverend, I thank you for healing me." I said, "No, brother, I didn't heal you. I just prayed for you. That's all I did. I prayed that the Lord would heal, that he would bring you out. I prayed scripture, the effectual fervent prayers of the righteous, they avail much. I prayed in the name of the Lord Jesus." Listen, Jesus, if his sickness, if it is not unto death, that's what old folk used to pray, say amen. If their sickness is not unto death, because Lord, you know whether or not they're going to survive, or whether or not they're going to end up in the operating room over in glory. And so, Father, if their sickness is not unto death, raise my brother up. Listen, the Lord raised the brother up, and I reminded him, it's not me, it's the Lord. I reminded him that it's not me, it's the word of God. I reminded him that I am nothing without God's strength that flows through me. Listen, the Lord needs somebody who will stand up and declare that what you see is not because of me, but what you see is because of what the Lord has done for me in my life. It was his strength and his strength alone that brought you out. Listen, your testimony, that's an example, an illustration of the strength of God. Someone said, "Well, Pastor, what can I share with others about God's strength?" Well, look in the mirror. You are the recipient of God's strength. I know you are, because you sing that song, "Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me." I once was lost. Anybody in here, I know I'm not by myself. Anybody streaming, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. It's not me, it's God's amazing grace. Look at somebody and say, "Share your testimony, brother." Look at somebody and say, "Share your testimony, honey." Because folk knew you back then, say amen, and they know you now. And when they see the change, you tell them that it's not about me, it's is all about what the Lord has done for me in my life. I was lost, but I called on the name of the Lord, and the Lord raised me. Somebody ought to say hallelujah. Me up. Amen. God is looking for somebody. They're looking for somebody who's humble enough.
Amen.
To declare their generation.
Yeah.
That the reason I've been born again is because of God's grace and His mercy. The reason why I'm able to stand in the midst of confusion is because of the Lord's strength in my life. And I dare you to lean and depend on Him. He'll give you strength, say beyond measure.
Amen.
Amen. So God had to fix the future for the faithful. Well, why? When we looked at, first of all, because in every generation, there will be a mouthpiece for the Lord. Then secondly, he had to do it because in every generation, there will be, those among the faithful who will be the examples of what his strength can do in the life of a human being. And then lastly, the Lord had to do it because there has to be somebody in every generation, who can stand up and tell the devil and the devils in life to shut up. Say amen. There's got to be, there's got to be somebody in every generation who will stand up to the devil and silence him. It's right there in the text. Y'all see it? Y'all see it? Yeah, out of the mouths of babes and nursing and infants, God has ordained strength because of the enemies of God. God needs somebody to battle those who hate him. And then those who hate the Lord will hate, his people. But that's all right. There's nothing new under the sun. I know you want everybody to like you.
Yeah.
Everybody look for friends everywhere. Folk got friends they don't even know on Facebook. Everybody wants friends. But I tell you, the best friend that you can have is JSU. Amen. And listen. God understands that. And so he has extended himself to be our friend, our great shepherd who will walk with us through every valley in life. And he'll be with us on the mountaintop. And he is a mighty good friend. You don't have, no friends on earth that can walk with you through every valley. The human beings can only go so far. Say amen. That's why we need Jesus. That's why you need Jesus, because human beings can only go so far with you. Say amen. But there ought to be somebody in here streaming who can declare that God has been with me through every valley in life, through every height, through every low. God has been with me, stood right by my side, never left me, never forsook me. God has always been there. And since he's always with me, then even in my generation, in your generation, in future generations, God is going to find somebody.
Amen.
Who will stand up to the devil and silence him. Silence, the enemy. Silence the avengers.
Yeah.
This is the reason why right here in the latter portion of this verse, this is the reason why. The reason why the Lord needed to fix the future for the faithful. That's the reason why he needed to do it is because of the enemy and the avenger. Say amen. You know, the devil just won't quit. Say amen. Somebody ought to say amen. Just say the devil just won't quit. He won't leave you alone. And it's right here in our text, after you have finished dealing with the enemy, then here come the avengers. Say amen. You see, after you have silenced the enemy, put the enemy to shame, then here comes the avengers, because they don't like what you did to the enemy. Here, the avengers are those after, yes, you have taken the sheet off of unrighteousness. The avengers come along and try to cover unrighteousness. Say amen. The avengers of those are the after you have silenced the enemy, then here come the avengers to speak up for him. And so the reason why our future needs to be fixed, the future for the faithful needs to be fixed, is because after you deal with the enemy, then here come the avengers. And we thank God that we serve a God who can handle the enemy and the avengers. Say amen. Listen, in the power of God, listen, all you need is the word of God. Listen, Jesus was the Son of God, and he could have spoke the devil, Lucifer himself, out of existence when he was tempted in the wilderness. Here come the devil. Listen, Jesus, you fasted 40 days and 40 nights. Jesus could have blinked him out of existence, but Jesus looked at him and said, listen, quoted the word, man does not live by bread alone, but he lives by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Look at somebody and say, just use the word and you can hush the devil up. The devil came to Jesus again. Listen, Jesus, the scripture said, as I have taken you to the highest point of the temple, Jesus jumped, because the scripture says that you will not dash your foot against the stone. And what he is saying, the devil said, no harm will come to you. But Jesus quoted the scripture that you shall not, will not, should never tempt the Lord thy God. Listen, I can't tempt God, test him, but I can ask him to meet my need. I can't test the Lord, no, but I can ask him to give me direction. I can't tell the Lord what to do, but as an humble servant, I can ask him, Lord, I need some strength. Lord, I need some guidance. Lord, I need some encouragement. Lord, I need just a little bit more faith. Anybody right around in there, Lord, I need just a little bit more encouragement. I need some more faith. I need some more strength. And listen, we can't tempt him, but we can ask him. And then the devil said to Jesus, amen, could have blinked him out of existence. Yeah. But here comes the devil finally to Jesus.
Yeah.
Saying, now listen, I know that you are a king. And that you're looking for some kingdoms to rule. Well, I got some kingdoms for you.
Uh-huh.
And all you have to do, Jesus, is bow down and worship me. Jesus could have blinked him out of existence.
Amen.
But the Lord used the word of God.
Amen.
Then the word of God said that thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shall you serve.
Amen.
What did the enemy do after Jesus quoted the last verse? Said the devil turned tail and he ran. Now he departed just for a season. That meant that he'll be back. But that's all right. Every time he comes back, I'm loaded with the word of God. Say amen. I said I'm loaded with God's word. And God's word is our ammunition. And when we use his word, we can keep the devil at bay. We can keep him silent. We can make him hush up and sit down. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Well, how did I do do it. Someone say, well, how can I keep the devil silent? Well, I'm glad you asked.
Yeah.
Well, listen, I want to encourage you, if you want to keep the devil at bay, if you want to deal with the enemies and the avenger, just keep on living for the Lord.
Amen.
Keep on living for the Lord. The Lord will hush up the mouth of the devil.
Yes.
Pastor, how do I, gain victory over the enemy and the avenger? Well, keep on praying. Stay on your bending knees, and it will hush up, the mouth of the enemy and the avenger. Well, Pastor, how do I deal with the devil? Well, I'm glad you asked. Keep on studying the word of the Lord, and Lord, will hush up the mouth of the avenger. Well, how do I, keep the devil, the enemy, and the avenger silent? Well, keep on reading the word of the Lord. Every time you have an opportunity, open up his word, and it might be the same verse that you read on yesterday. But I heard that God's word, it never grows old. It's new every morning. And so if you don't have a scripture to find that you can read every day, just open the book up to Psalm 23 and read those words. It'll bless you every day. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because, Lord, you're with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. And the last verse of blessing, real good. Surely, I said, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life on this side. And then the word of God, his grace and his mercy will take me to glory over on the other side. So just keep on reading the word of God, and it'll make the devil hush up. Well, if you're still looking for something to share with the devil, I dare you to turn over to the Gospels, and you will find that there's a man by the name of Jesus, whom God said to be, the sacrifice for our sin. The reason why the devil tried to keep Jesus from going to Calvary, because he knew that once Jesus went to Calvary, it would hush him up for good. Ain't God all right? So God sent his only begotten Son down into this world, and Jesus was born in Bethlehem, wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And when Jesus was born, cattle started bowing, and sheep started bowing, and goats started bowing. And the reason why they all bowed down is because they knew who Jesus was, and they knew who the Lord is. Ain't God all right? And who Jesus would forever be. Ain't the Lord all right? And so if there's some faithful in this place, if there are those who are faithful who are streaming with us, then there ought to be some thanksgiving and praise down in our spirit. If you know who Jesus is, you ought to give him praise and glory. If you know know who Jesus will always be. You ought to give him praise and glory. If you know he's the great Alpha and Omega, you ought to give him praise and glory. If you know he's the beginning and the end, you ought to give him praise and glory. Ain't God all right? If she can bow down and pray his name, if goats and animals and cows can bow down and pray his name, surely you and I, all on a Sunday morning, hope you brought some praise. Hope you're just not a spectator. I hope you brought some praise. Because he's worthy of all of our praise and all of our glory. Ain't the Lord all right? Well, that baby grew up and walked the streets of Jerusalem. Healed the sick and gave sight to the blind, helped the lame to walk and helped the dumb to talk and raised Lazarus from the dead. But I praise him most of all because one Friday evening he took an old rugged cross of Golgotha Hill, and when he got on that hill, he allowed sinful men to nail his hands. He allowed sinful men to nail his feet. And he never said a complaining word. Ain't the Lord all right? We live in a time when folk are complaining. Ain't got much good to say. Talking about this and talking about that. Ain't the Lord all right? But oh, I've discovered when you learn how to praise his name. When you lift him up, when praise go up, blessing come down. Ain't the Lord all right? The Lord will bless a praising spirit. Ain't the Lord all right? I get into conversations too. I talk about current events. We talk about this and we talk about that. But at the end of the conversation, I just say these words. The Lord is good. Ain't the Lord all right? The Lord is in control. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, he's in control. Because the future is fixed. Ain't God all right? Well, they nailed his hands. They nailed his feet. They lifted him up. They stretched him wide. He hung his head and the Lord died. They took him down and laid him in a borrowed tomb. He laid in that old tomb all night on a Friday night. Laid in that old tomb all day on Saturday. Because early Sunday morning, the Lord got up with all power in his hand. Power to put some running in your feet. Power could put some clapping in your hands. Power to put some joy. Anybody got any joy in this place? Joy all in your heart. I'm not joy. It'll get in your feet. I'm not. It'll get in your mind. Ain't the Lord all right? If you know it all right, then wave a hand. If you know it all right, hold a storm your feet. If you know it all right, you ought to fist bump somebody and tell them Jesus is good.